It's going to take 252. Sudassam vajjam anyesam. Attenopana duddhasam. Paresam hiso vajjani. Opunati atabhusam. Attano panachadeti. Kalinva itvasato. Sudassam. Vajjanyesam attanopana duddhasam paresam hiso vajjani opunati attabhusam attanopana chadeti kalinva pitava. So the next one also related the same subject. Parvajjani pasissa nityam ujjana sannino. Asvatasvaddanti araso asvakthaya parvajjani pasissa nityam ujjana sannino. Asvatasvaddanti araso asvakthaya. The meaning of the first stanza easily seen are others' fault, hard indeed to see our own one's own, like chaff one winnows other's fault, but one's own fault one hides, as a crafty fowler conceal himself by camouflage. This saying of the Buddha also very important. Paresam vajjan. People always try to find out loopholes, mistakes, and for them to pass remarks, criticize, to condemn, to accuse, to blame. This is the nature of human mind. It is very difficult for them to keep away from such attitude. We cannot understand what they really gain by doing that. I don't think they gain anything. They may get bad names, or they may create enemies, or misunderstanding. But they won't get anything for their own benefit. Even then, they will never stop this. They take so much of troubles and pains and spin to go here and there, to pass remarks, to criticize, to condemn, to accuse. By doing that, at that time, I think they experience some sort of satisfaction. They gain some sort of satisfaction thinking that they have done something. But in return, they gain bad names or create enemies. A lot of disturbances. So that is why the Buddha purposely mentioned this, for us to learn our weakness. This is one of our human weaknesses. I thought only human beings are doing this. Because other living beings also have their own language. Devas and Brahmas and devils and ghosts and spirits also have their own language. Only human beings tell lies and pass remarks, but not others. We cannot take this as the development of the mind. Some sort of impatience, intolerance, and related to jealousy. Otherwise, there is no reason for people to pass remarks. Jealousy supports, and intolerance and impatience become the cause. After that, what they do? They find out the background. Take for instance, a poor man, after working very hard for many years, could manage to build his own house, buy a motor car, get married to a pretty girl, and they are living very peacefully, leading comfortable life. Others cannot tolerate. They want to pass remarks. So now they are enjoying. We know what their father was doing. And when they were young, we know how they lived. They had not even enough food or enough clothing. Now they are enjoying their life. This is the nature of our human mind. We cannot keep quiet without passing such caustic remarks. In four sublime states, this is one of them. Metta, Karuna, Mudita. This is under Mudita. We had to cultivate sympathetic feeling or to appreciate, to share others' happiness. when they enjoy their life without harboring jealousy or passing remarks. It is so difficult. The Buddha included this item under sublime state. That means above the normal human way of life. And now you can understand the difficulty of abstaining from that. When others enjoy their life, our duty is, without passing remarks or criticizing or condemning, appreciate their achievement, their development, their happiness, then we also can share that happiness. So we had to cultivate our mind up to that level. Otherwise, there is no development in our mind. Whatever knowledge we have, no development. To do that, we have to train our mind. We cannot train this mind by force. Fear of God, fear of punishment, fear of existing law of the country cannot train human minds. Remember this. Because of fear or fear of punishment, they try to abstain or keep away from certain things, but not through understanding. The Buddhist attitude is observing precepts or religious principles not as law given by somebody, not because that they had to suffer or somebody may punish, but by understanding that attitude is wrong, that can create enormous problems, sufferings, unhappiness, disturbances. Through this understanding, we have to train the mind. That is why the other day I told you, when you observe sila or precept or our religious principles, we have two aspects. Not only negative aspects, not to do, not to do, not to do, not only that. Not to do is one aspect, but to do is the other aspect. So you can keep away from certain bad deeds, certain immoral, knowing they are wrong, or by thinking that you have to suffer if you have committed them. But that is not enough. Let us take one or two examples, then you can understand. You try to keep away from destroying other living beings, the life of other living beings, by knowing that it is wrong. But that is not enough. You had to cultivate your kindness, your compassion, your sympathy, your cooperation, your understanding towards them. then the positive life. This sila divided into two, as charitra sila and varitra sila. Varitra means keeping. But many people think observing sila precept means keep away from certain things. That's all. That is not enough. You have to complete the varitra and charitra both. Charitra means duty. Certain duties you have to fulfill. So what are the duties? Cultivate your kindness, your compassion, your understanding, your harmony towards other living beings. Let us take the next one. We try not to steal or not to do swindling or bluffing or cheating or smuggling. Yes, we observe it. Keep it. Not enough. We have to cultivate honesty or sincerity in our mind. So unless we develop this virtue in our mind, there is no guarantee that we will never break the precept. Because we have not enriched the mind with virtues and understanding. So when we develop understanding and the virtues in our mind, we feel it is impossible for us to do such bad things. Otherwise, the chances arise. People make a lot of bad things and mistakes. That means they observe the precept only negative aspect, without cultivating the positive side. When a person attained the first stage of sainthood, sotapanna, there are certain things that he cannot do. It is impossible for that person to commit certain things because such ideas never appear in their mind. Then the guarantee is there. This person is cultivating, developing, marching towards the final goal, salvation, without going backward. That person never goes backward, only forward. But our mental attitude at this level, there is no guarantee that we never go back or we never change our mind. Or we never make mistake. We try not to do, but circumstances, environment, or irritation force our mind to do certain things although we have learned that it is wrong. Although we tried our best not to do that. Because at that time, we lose our determination, mental energy to abstain from that. For our personal benefit, for our gain, or to escape from certain problems or troubles, we violate, we break. But those who have cultivated their mind through understanding and determined not to commit certain bad things under any circumstances, they never violate. One who attained first stage of sainthood, Sotapanna, never. Because he cannot. Never change the mind. Nobody in this world who can change the mind. There is an incident. One day, the Buddha was invited by a very devout devotee, and after dana, he gave a sermon. Then he attained the first stage of sainthood, Sotapanna, this man. Mara was watching this, because Mara is very unhappy when a person becomes religious minded, virtuous. Religious people, virtuous people are his enemies. Just like some religions or religionists in this world believe the followers of other religions are their enemies. It is mentioned in their holy books also. Those who do not believe in their God are enemies. It is mentioned very clearly. So Mara thinks all those good people are his enemies. That is why he had a big battle with the Buddha to stop gaining his enlightenment, interrupt, disturb him. Because he knew after gaining his enlightenment, he will pave the way for others to be good. So Mara doesn't like that. He wants people to be bad. So, when the Buddha left that house, Mara transformed himself, just like the Buddha figure, came to his house and told him, "Do you know what I told you a short while ago? I remember it is wrong. It is a mistake. It is not like that." Then he gave the opposite meaning of the advice given by the Buddha. But this person has already attained first stage of sainthood. There is nobody in this world who can change his mind. Then he said, "I believe that Buddhas have no two words, only one word. Therefore, I don't believe that you are the real Buddha." Then Mara disappeared. This is the nature. Not only that, they are willing to sacrifice their life for the sake of their principle. Because this body is nothing, no value, but by upholding the principles, they can see the real value. Because after a few years, we die. After our death, this body, this life, separates. So this is impermanent. But the principle that I uphold never die. never disappear. I can continue life after life, but I cannot carry this body life after life. I drop it here. But I never drop my principle. That is how we had to cultivate all the great virtues. When you study the previous birth stories of the Buddha, you can understand this very clearly. How he had to suffer physically and mentally because of his principles. When others could not agree with his principles, they wanted to disturb him, torture him, beat him, but he never withdrew his principles. Willing to die, willing to sacrifice life for the sake of that principle, because this will die, but the principles never die. Rūpaṁ jīrati macchānaṁ nāma guttaṁ na jīrati. Another saying of the Buddha. Rūpa, our body. Jīrati, decay and disappear. Macchānaṁ, human. Human body, decay and disappear. Rūpaṁ jīrati macchānaṁ nāma guttaṁ na jīrati. The name, the influence created by that person, name na jīrati, never decay, never die. Remember this. All our bodies decay and die, disappear after a few years' time. But all the good qualities, virtues that we have cultivated never decay, never die. Life after life, we can continue further and further and further increase. That is how people attain sainthood, arahantahood, or bodhisattahood, or buddhahood. It's a gradual development by upholding principles. So there is nothing for them to bring from outside, from heaven or hell or anywhere, there is nothing. That is inner development. All the qualities, virtues, knowledge, wisdom, understanding, there is nothing to gain from outside. Now when I give this idea, you take this into your mind, you think, you digest, then you understand. I cannot create that understanding in your mind if you cannot digest. It is your duty. So that capacity, that potential in you. So outsiders cannot give anything. They can give ideas for you to think and understand. Not by force, not by threatening, not by creating fear in your mind, but through understanding. Then the development takes place. Here in this saying, we had to take this seriously. into our mind. Not to pass remark, although they are wrong, because there is a way to approach and tell them if they are wrong, without hurting their feeling, without humiliating, without disturbing their mind. You can point out kindly, gently, politely, friendly way, you can tell, I have seen that you are doing this kind of thing. Do you think it is suitable for you to do? Do you know that it is wrong? Do you know it is immoral? Do you know you harm yourself? Very friendly. Then that person never get angry, appreciate your attitude. So we have to learn this technique without scolding at once, without shouting. And also, you must know the time, suitable time to approach the person. In Mangala Sutta, it is mentioned, Kalena Dhamma Sakaccha. Dhamma Sakaccha means discussion, talk about the Dhamma. Kalena, at proper time. You must know the time. Sometimes people's minds are not ready to listen. They are concentrating on their own problems and troubles and worrying for certain things. Or they are very angry. Or they are very busy with their personal commitment and responsibility. Now you go and start to tell Dhamma, talk to that person. He'll chase you away. That is why the Buddha says, Kalena Dhamma Sakaccha. You must know a proper time when that person's mind is ready to accept, to listen to your advice or the Dhamma, then that is the time. So, to point out the weakness of a person, you should not do in front of others, to humiliate personally, privately, without allowing others to know that you passed remarks, pointed out the mistake. And then you never create any problems, and they never become your enemies. They appreciate. I can remember, during my stay here, even during my stay in Sri Lanka and India, how ordinary devotees, not only monks, how they have pointed certain weaknesses that they have noticed. Then, very kindly, personally, come and tell us, that day I heard you were talking like this. That day I saw you were doing something like this. Do you think it is suitable for you? After listening to my talk, many of our elderly members who have maturity and understanding, on many occasions, they approached me. They told me, Reverend, the other day, you used this word, or you mentioned this. It's according to my belief, I don't think it is advisable for you to do that. Then I accept. If I come to know that it is wrong. This is the way that we learn. We must never regard a person who point out our weakness as an enemy. Regard him or her as a very good friend. That is why I told you, you must know the technique, how to test. I know many people come and discuss with us, I have seen so and so is doing this, but I don't know how to test. Because he or she feels that person is hurt, that person's mind. So, ask our opinion, our advice, how to approach and how to tell that he is wrong. That is very important. We have to learn from others. Now, if I have dirt here, I cannot see, but you can see. And then you point out, Reverend, there's a big, what you call, dark spot here on your face, what is that? Then I come to know, yes, all our mistakes that you point out is exactly like, we have to take in that. Not to condemn you, not to accuse, to belittle, but to point out that it is wrong. Here the Buddha's teaching is, it is very easy for us to find out others' mistake. Very easily he can pass remarks. Sometimes they are not wrong, but we think that they are wrong. We keep an eye on to find out only mistake. But we do not keep an eye on to see all the good deeds that they are doing. Now this is another problem. There's a saying, when I am right, everybody keep quiet. When I am wrong, everybody remember me. Yes, it is true. Because everybody pass remark. Example. Now I have been doing religious work, good work, here in this country for more than 43 years. But how many key people keep an eye on me, what sort of good work that I am doing. Everybody keep quiet. But if I make a mistake today, tomorrow, headline in newspaper. Here you can understand the nature of the human mind. Because everybody is waiting to point out only mistake. Not the good thing. Good thing they keep quiet. They want to find out only mistake. Yes, everybody makes mistake. That is why I told you, we had to admit our mistake when others point out if we are wrong. If we are not wrong, then we have to explain, we have to justify what we have said, what we have done is not a mistake, but you misunderstood. Then we have to clarify. There are many things people misunderstand according to their way of thinking. So we have to clarify. But we should not get angry when others point out our weaknesses, then example is given here, easily seen are others' faults, hard indeed to see are one's own. That means very difficult for us to admit our mistake, fault, because we have very strong egoism. That egoism is the number one enemy in our life. Because of that egoism, we try to justify all the bad and wicked and immoral thing that we have committed. We want to argue. We want to fight. To justify nothing wrong. That is egoism. Never ready to surrender. Surrender means to admit. Yes, I know. I made a mistake. I know it is wrong. Then it is gentleness. Those who shout and fight and quarrel with others, when they point out their mistake, their cunningness and egoism, these two things fight. Such people never get the chance to develop, cultivate their way of life. Forever they remain like that. Therefore, we must be humble. The more we become humble, the more easily we can cultivate. But if we are very stubborn, skeptical, and very stiff, we never get the chance to adjust, to correct our mind, our way of life. These are very important points for us to think seriously, to adjust our way of life. Here it is mentioned, those who cultivate paddy, and they take the paddy into a vessel and go and throw like this. Then the winds take out all the, what we call, dried, unwanted things, and remains only paddy in that vessel. So in the same manner, those who want to find out others' mistake, bad thing, wrong thing, always go on shouting, announcing, and broadcasting, so-and-so is like this, so-and-so is like this, so-and-so is like this, whole day and night, go on talking. When they get together, few people, they always talk ill of others. How many people are there to talk the good thing that people are doing? Always. Let us take politicians. Let us take our Prime Minister, Dr. Mahathir. All the politicians are trying to do some service. Day and night they suffer. They have to think, they have to work, they have to plan, they have to discuss. So many things they have to do. How many people are there to appreciate them? People say they are cunning, they are cruel, they are wicked, they are selfish. These are the remarks. But the good thing that they are doing, they don't want to talk. They say bribery and corruptions and so many things. Yes, they are not what you call perfect. they have their own weaknesses. But we also must learn to appreciate the services that they render to maintain peace and order, and to cultivate, to develop, to maintain so many things. Otherwise, everything become chaotic condition. If they do not devote their time for that. So instead of criticizing, accusing, blaming, passing remarks, we also must encourage them, appreciate their services. And religious people are doing wonderful service to advise others, to guide others, to show the correct path, to have proper understanding for them to make use of this human life without misusing, without abusing. But those religious teachers have their own weaknesses.
Are these the problem with us? So by knowing our mentality, the Buddha has given this advice. It is very easy for us to see all the mistakes done by the others, but we always hide our own weaknesses.
Our own mistakes, our own immoral practices. Just like here he has given a parable, a man who want to catch birds, he go and hide under a bush and holding the net. The birds come and they down, they spread the net. He is hiding. So, we always hide our own weaknesses, our mistakes. By doing that, we always try to point out others' mistakes. That is our weakness. So just now I told you, we are not perfect. Everybody makes mistakes, but we should not develop that egoism not to admit when somebody points out our weakness or the mistake committed by us. Accept. Then we get the chance to develop. That egoism we had to reduce. This egoism is so deeply rooted into our mind. Now we have four stages to attain nirvana. Sotapanna, Sakadagami, Anagami, Arahant. That is the higher stage. Either the Buddha or Arahant. Then Nirvana. To attain step by step, we had to reduce or unload or eradicate certain human weaknesses. But first stage, we unload only three weaknesses. Second stage, we reduce two more, but cannot eradicate completely, but reduce. It is so strong. Then the third stage, we eradicate those two that we subdue during the second stage. That is anatta, third stage. To attain the highest stage, arahanta, there are five more. Still we carry these five weaknesses up to the last stage. See how strong they are in our mind. Among those five, our pride, our egoism, still we maintain in our mind. It is not an easy thing to withdraw. We always try to justify. After making mistake, we want to argue, we want to fight, justify. That is egoism. So we carry this mentality, this attitude, up to the last stage. When we drop that one also, then only attain the higher stage. See how strong it is. The troubles here in this world, most of those problems and war and calamities, fighting, quarrelings, are based on this egoism or pride. They want to maintain. They want to control. They want to be superior. So, that is a weakness. It is not the development of the mind. Now you say, you are very hot-tempered. And you try to justify. You must be careful, I am very hot-tempered. But you never admit that is the weakness of your mind. If you are a hot-tempered person, that means your understanding is very poor. Understanding capacity is very low. That is why you allow anger to flare up at once, without considering, without thinking, without applying patience and tolerance or the qualities, no courage. Let go. That means mind is very poor, very weak. And because of that attitude, you have to face so many problems. People become enemies, they can beat you, they can kill you because of that attitude. So egoism is the biggest enemy which encourage, persuade us to maintain, uphold these weaknesses. Never allow to withdraw. Never allow the mind to know that we are wrong. But great people in this world, when you read what Confucius had said, Lao Tzu, Socrates, Jesus, the Buddha, simple sayings like this, you can understand. Although they are great people, they become very humble. Because of their greatness, because they have no egoism. And then, those who think that they know better than others, but they do not know that they are foolish people. Those who think like that. 3-4 religious leaders and philosophers have mentioned this. When Socrates was asked, because he was known as the most learned, very wise man who got wonderful knowledge and wisdom, then somebody asked, people believe actually you know everything. You have wonderful knowledge. Can you tell me actually what you know? Then Socrates thought, actually I know only one thing. That I do not know. That no, I know that. That is the wisdom. Now if you know that you do not know, that is your wisdom. If you think you know, There is no wisdom in you. But earlier, the Buddha has mentioned the same thing before Socrates. How did he say? Yo balo manyati balyang pandito chapite nso balo cha panditamani sve balo ti uttati. It is so simple. If a foolish man thinks that he knows, he is wise. Forever he remains as a fool. If a foolish man knows that he is a fool, he is a wise man, the Buddha says, because he gets the chance to cultivate, develop, because he knew that he is a fool. And these are beautiful sayings. Confucius also has said the same thing. Here Socrates also had, they are brilliant. They had wonderful understanding. So, we had to reduce our egoism. We had to reduce our belief that we know. Now, you go and ask some of your friends, why don't you come and join with us to go and attend this Friday talk? Oh, I know, you think what Reverend say, he repeat, go on repeating, same thing, I know what he talk. That is the remark. But when you ask him to analyze what he knows, there's nothing. That is a weakness. So, the more you become humble, the more you become simple, the more you get the chance to cultivate, to develop your knowledge, your understanding, your way of life, without facing so many problems. Then the next one, Paravajjānu pasissa nityaṁ ujjhāna sanyino āsavā tattva addhanti. The meaning, he who sees others' faults and is ever irritable, the corruptions of such a one grow. He is far from the destructions of corruption. This is the effect, result you have to face. Paravajjānu pasissa nityaṁ ujjhāna sanyino. All those who always go and talking about ill of others, everywhere they talk, criticizing, accusing, blaming, talking ill of others. Paravajjānu pasissa nityaṁ ujjhāna sanyino. So what will happen? Āsavā tassa vaddanti. By doing that, they develop their mental impurities. Because when they talk ill of others, they develop jealousy, they develop anger, they develop intolerance, impatience, all the good qualities they corrupt. So it is a very dangerous attitude to criticize, to condemn others. By doing that, we pollute our own mind and we harm ourselves. Here the Buddha says, āraso āsavakkhaya. It is very difficult for such people to eradicate their mental impurities, corruptions from their mind to attain sainthood or arahanthood or nirvana. Forever they are going on grumbling, wasting their valuable life for nothing. So when it is necessary, it is your duty to point out your children, or your parents, or your brothers and sisters, or your friends, when they make mistake, there is a way how to approach and tell them. The Buddha's advice to the children, he said, amongst all the good qualities and duties and responsibilities towards your parents, providing food and medicine and bathing, assisting and ministering them, but amongst all these duties, the highest duty that you can perform towards your father and mother is to correct if they are wrong. See? Don't say, oh, I cannot tell, he is my father, he is my mother, how can I tell like this? No. That is why I told you there must be a method or time, technique, how to do that. Many people come and ask this question. I know my father is doing wrong, my mother is doing wrong thing. I don't know how to approach and tell them that they are wrong. This Venerable Sariputta, the chief disciple of the Buddha, he came from a very orthodox Brahmin's family. His mother never changed her mind. He remained by worshipping Brahmas and Devas and performing all the rites and rituals, but she never followed the Buddha's way of life or Sariputta's way of life. Now Sariputta was thinking what to do now, because simply by advising doesn't work. She never accept. So stubborn. But he felt that he will be failing his duty toward the mother because she is doing wrong thing according to his wisdom and understanding. So how to pave the correct path? She is not ready to listen. Then what he did? One evening he went to his house. He said he wanted to spend the night. So when he was sleeping there, at night, he had a very big stomach complaint, pain, purging. Purging and purging and purging, he could not stop. And there's nobody to attend to him. Only old lady is there. Then, Sariputta was the most perfect, holy disciples. Then the four guardian devas, having seen that Sariputta is suffering from this problem, they came in disguise as humans and cleansed, attended to Sariputta. The mother was watching, old lady, whole night. They are going and coming and going and coming and cleaning and washing. This old lady, next day morning, she asked, what happened to you? And who are those people who came and attended to you last night? Then he said, they are the four guardian devas. Attended to me because I had very bad stomach problem. They cleaned. Oh, you are higher than those devas for them to come and attend to you. Oh, you can understand. If I am not higher than them, they will never come and attend to me. Then she changed her mind. see the technique. She realized that her way of life is not the real holy. Her son was leading a real holy life. That is why devas also come and attend it. Then he is satisfied. And there is another story. Always I can see this in many books, but it is not in Tripitaka, in the teachings of the Buddha. They have narrated this story later, but very important. We don't want to say it is wrong, but contradict to the teachings of the Buddha. Moggallana, also his chief disciple, who could manage to perform any kind of miracle, highest miracle. His mother also did not accept the teachings of the Buddha. She has done a lot of bad deeds. After her death, she was born in hell. Moggallana, having seen that the mother is suffering in hell, he was thinking how to release her, to get rid of the suffering, and discussed with the Buddha also. Then it is mentioned in their writing. The Buddha advised him, you must radiate your metta, your kindness, your compassion towards your mother. Now she is suffering in hell. Through the influence of this radiation, you can release your mother from the hell. So he did that. After that, she had the chance to get out of the hell. But this will contradict to the teachings of the Buddha, karma. Because one person cannot change the karma committed by another person. The Buddha also cannot do that. God also cannot do that. So if she is suffering in hell due to her own bad karma, Sariputta, Moggallana, Buddha cannot do anything unless he finishes. Because it is not eternal hell. There is a limited period. But there are certain karmas we can overcome, we can topple by creating more powerful karma, good karma. But we have to do that personally. Another person cannot do that. Then you can ask this question. What is the meaning of transference of merits to departed ones to release their suffering? Yes. By transferring merits, we cannot change their suffering. If they are in animal life or ghost, you use the word hungry ghost, ghost or devil or any other, in any other forms, due to their bad karma. It is impossible for you to change that life by burning papers or burning houses or slaughtering animals or transferring merits. Impossible. Then why do you do that? There are four stages among those spirit groups. Nijhamatannika, Kuppipasika, Pansupisachika, Paradattupajivi. Four groups according to their karma. Some of those spirits experience burning sensation day and night. burning and burning, whole body is burning. Due to certain bad karmas they have committed. Throughout their life, there is nobody who can stop. One day, Moggallana, who can perform miracles, when he was going out for his arms round with his begging bowl, he has seen through his psychic power one of those spirits who was suffering from this burning sensation, yeni. He thought he can quench this thirst or burning sensation by pouring water into the mouth. He stopped going out for arms round the whole day, collect water and pour into the mouth of this spirit. Still he could not stop burning. This is the nature of their life. So others cannot change. Another group, Nijjhama Tannika, they have very strong attachment, craving and jealousy towards their property and valuable things that they claim as their property. And rebirth has taken place in such a place because of that craving. It is very dangerous. So, by transferring merit, we cannot change their life. There is another group, Paansupisaji, who spend their life dirty places, drains, lavatories, dirty, filthy places. They are very unfortunate. By transferring merit, we cannot change their lives. By transferring merit, we cannot change the animal's life. Then there is another group, Paradattopajivi, who are waiting to receive the merits. They are the only one who can receive and who will be benefited when we transfer the merit. Then who are those people? If they have done very bad karma during their previous birth, they will suffer either in hell or any other unfortunate state. If they have done certain good karmas, they will be born either as human beings or devas or some other fortunate living being. So in between there are many who do not commit very bad karmas and who do not perform good karmas. They work, they earn, they enjoy, they die. They are the ones who remain there without enough petrol to run their motor car, stranded in the federal highway, waiting for the petrol. When you transfer the merit, means that you are pouring petrol into their tank. Then they start their motor cars. They are the ones who can deceive, but not others. Since we do not know where they are, whether they can deceive or not, we do our duty. We will be benefited when you do some meritorious deeds. If they cannot receive, we are benefited. Now you invite some of your relatives or friends for a dinner. If they did not turn up, you enjoy your food. Exactly like this, you do some meritorious deeds. If they don't want, if they cannot receive, you enjoy your own merit. You have not wasted anything. So, here the last sayings of the Buddha, Asavatasya Vardhanti Araso Asavakkhaya. So, if you spend our life by criticizing, accusing, blaming, and watching others' mistakes, by neglecting our duties, without cultivating our way of life, we are going on polluting our mind. We never get the chance to purify our own mind. Therefore, try as much as possible to avoid criticism, accusation, passing remarks, and condemning others. But when it is necessary, tell them their mistake and where the mistake is, so they are loophole. You can support them to correct them, even your parents. So the Buddha's advice also, try to correct if your parents are wrong. That is the highest service you can render towards your parents. I think enough. Why? What is your question today? Why you had a dream? What is your question?